I will turn the podium over to Dwayne Donovan.
Okay, we've come to the long-awaited homogeneous analysis program. First paper is authored by Paul Chirik and Joseph Marola from Virginia Polytechnic Institute and State University. The paper will be presented by Paul Chirik. Paul is a senior at VPI. He's going on to Caltech to pursue his graduate studies later in the year. The title of his paper today is The Aqueous Homogeneous Hydrogenation of Olefins and Acetylenes by Iridium Amine and Rhodium Amine Catalyst.
Today what I'd like to talk about is basically the development of an aqueous hydrogenation catalyst. And the way we go about it is a little bit different than what's previously been reported. Well, before I start with that, the first thing we should ask is, why do you want to do aqueous catalysis? First, it has several advantages. As alluded to earlier this morning, there's an environmental push to reduce aromatics and other types of organic solvents in the chemical industry. Secondly, there's an inherent economical and safety advantage of using water. And finally, equally as important in my mind, is simplified catalyst product separation. And I think this one's important when you take into account what types of metals we're dealing with here. If you use an aqueous system with rhodium and iridium, precious metals, and you use a water-soluble substrate that, as you reduce, it becomes insoluble, then you can just skim the product right off the top of the reactor. And you don't even have to touch your catalyst. You can just leave it right in solution, and you don't have to worry about losing a rhodium or iridium if you don't have decomposition. Well, why do we have to do this research? Well, there's some limitations of current catalysts. And primarily, firsthand, is the catalysts that are used homogeneously now, they're not soluble in water. So that doesn't really help you out when you're trying to do homogeneous catalysis. And more importantly, when you think of organometallic chemistry, you think of Schlenk lines, dry boxes, and keeping air and water away from your stuff because it'll react with water to kill your catalyst. In designing our system, what we decided to do was to take a look at what was currently in the literature in terms of rhodium and iridium homogeneous hydrogenation catalysts. And the first type of catalyst we find is with rhodium. And he's reported by Trock and Osborne in the late 60s, mid 70s. And these are cationic complexes, the type of rhodium diene L2, where diene is either norbornadiene or cyclooctadiene. And L2 is a tertiary phosphine. Now, they found these catalysts were active for olefin reduction in solvents like ethanol and acetone. But I think the most important thing in this work is twofold. First, they found that they selectively reduced acetylenes to olefins, stopping at the olefin stage, which is unprecedented for homogeneous catalysts. And more importantly, in terms of our work, what they were able to show was that as you increase the basicity of the phosphine and the donating power of the phosphine, you increase the basicity of the metal, which increased the activity of the catalyst. Later, Bob Crabtree at Yale showed that with iridium, he took basically the same type of system that Trock and Osborne had, using COD tertiary phosphine cationic complex. But the most important thing he found was that these catalysts were most active in methylene chloride. And there's actually an interesting story on how they found this. The graduate student is named George Morris, who was working on this at the time, and he kept on. When he was doing they originally started out using acetone and ethanol like Trock and Osborne did. But George Morris kept on getting this precipitate of what they thought was decomposition of their catalyst, and it was actually shown to be decomposition of their catalyst. And he was getting sick of cleaning the stuff out of his reactor. So he's like, oh, the heck with this. You know, I always have to use methylene chloride to get the stuff out, so I'll just throw everything in methylene chloride. And he didn't tell Crabtree. And Crabtree writes that, you know, if he would have came to me and said that, I would have never told him to do that because it wouldn't have worked. Well, actually, what they found was it was the most active homogeneous catalyst known. And they were able to get 4,000 to 6,000 cycles per hour, and this was at room temperature. And in the literature, they report most of their work at 0°C because things were going too fast for them to measure. So, and importantly also, is that they were able to reduce tetrasubstituted olefins, which is it's difficult sometimes for homogeneous systems. While several aqueous iridium catalysts have been developed in our group, and the first one is iridinyl trispPme3H2 chloride. Now, if you look at that at first, it is active for olefin reduction and acetylene reduction in water. The activity isn't so great. But I think the most important thing about this catalyst is you can't point to any ligand on that metal that's what you would predict to be water soluble. There's no functional ligand that would induce water solubility, which is another route to get water soluble catalysts. What people were able to show was that the chloride is associated from the metal center, allowing water solubility. And H2O would then coordinate. And that would be reduced, that would be displaced by the substrate, and it could be reduced. Well, that turned out to be a problem in terms of activity because there's only one active site on the metal. So in order to make the system more active, chelated phosphines are now under investigation, where bisdimethylphosphenoethane is being used, where only two phosphines are on the metal center, and there's a extra active site. And these actually have been found to be much more active than the trispPme3 complex. So why amines? Honestly, I think phosphines really smell bad. And I don't want to work with them. but maybe that's not the best scientific explanation. I think maybe a more important question to deal with first is why not amines? I was surprised when I did the literature search on this stuff that no one's ever looked at using aliphatic bidentate amines in homogeneous houses with a late transition metal like iridium. And the reason for that is twofold again. That people, hard soft acid base theory is primarily, I guess, one problem. Is people think that a hard base like an amine couldn't coordinate well to a very soft acid like iridium. And also, people in our group have been able to show that you can actually activate an NH bond to form a metal hydride complex. So why amine? Well, they're good sigma donors. An aliphatic amine doesn't have any potential for back bonding with the metal center. So you would think that the basicity of the metal would increase, and hence we can increase our activity. Also, I think these are interesting in terms of just the chemistry of them, because like I said, there wasn't much reported in terms of classical Werner complexes of cobalt, trisethylene, diamine. And importantly, too, is we can look at a large selection of diamines that are commercially available. The phosphine chemistry, you can buy easily the tetramethyl version, dimethyl, but not much is known as of a dimethyl or monomethyl. You have to make that yourself, and that can be kind of tricky. Well, this is how I made my catalyst precursor, where we took that iridium CuD dichloride dimer, just slotted the reactive two equivalents of diamine and methylene chloride solution, and you make the pentacoordinated iridium atom. The amines that left out were ethylene diamine, monomethylethylene diamine, and N-dimethylethylene diamine, and NM prime dimethylethylene diamine. The yields are pretty good, 65 to 80%, and I characterized these by proton NMR, carbon NMR, and elemental analysis. It's important to note on this slide, while it's up here, in methylene chloride and in the solid state, we believe that the chloride ion is attached. And this is borne out in NMR data, where the NN dimethyl, or the monomethyl, where you have an asymmetric amine on there, is you observe only one type of resonance in the NMR spectrum, which indicates that the molecule is functional in 5-coordinate. More importantly, though, these complexes are soluble in water. And that's what we believe the structure is in solid state, where we have a square planar cationic iridium complex. And again, this is observed in the NMR spectrum, where you start to see now two different, in the case of the monomethyl complex, you can notice in the NMR, in the proton NMR spectrum, two different types of olefinic residues. In the COD ring, as well as in the ethylene diamine backbone. When you use a tetra-alkylated ethylene diamine derivative, you get a different type of reactivity. In methylene chloride, if you allow two equivalents of diamine to react with the dimer, you get this unusual iridium ion pair complex. Well, I use the word unusual kind of in quotes there because in iridium, an ion pair of this type hasn't been reported yet. But in rhodium, it has. And with the rhodium chemistry, they take the corresponding rhodium dimer here. And it was postulated that if you ever took an amine with two methyl groups or more on it, you got the ion pair. Which is kind of funny if you think about it, because I've shown now with the iridium chemistry that you don't get that. So that was kind of a question that we had and we looked at. I'll show you in a bit. So we thought, well, maybe it's a steric problem where the methyl groups are just too big and this nitrogen carbon bond distance is too short and you can't displace the chlorine to make the 5-4 net atom. So we figured, well, let's look at a bigger amine. So we took tetraethylethylene diamine, allowed that to react with the iridium dimer, and you get this complex, where you get two equivalents of the anion, which occurs from the split of the bridge. But now, the amine is reacted with the methylene chloride to liberate two equivalents of chloride and form this imidazole azole ring, which is a dication. This kind of chemistry has been reported in the literature just for diamine reacting with methylene chloride. But it was intriguing that you don't see this behavior with the tetramethylene. So the formation of the ion pair complex was a curiosity. And what we actually found was that if you take the ion pair and put it in methylene chloride, there's actually an equilibrium that exists. At first, when you just dissolve the complex, you have a 50-50 mixture, of course, of the cation and the anion. But if you add, at first what we try to do is to add tetramethylethylene diamine and hope to convert some of this anion into a square planar or kind of coordinated atom. That never worked. And that was kind of puzzling why that never happened. It would heat it up and you wouldn't get a reaction. Well, I said, let's try the other thing. Let's see what happens if you add chloride. Well, when you add chloride ion, you actually decrease the amount of cation you have and you increase the amount of anion. So what we came to believe, well, there's an equilibrium that existed here, as shown in this equation. And it lies way to the right. So using that thinking, we said, well, if there is some way we can control the nucleophilicity of the chloride and not allow it to attack our cation, then maybe we can make what we were trying to make with the other complex. So we said, well, let's put it in water and see what happens. And sure enough, what happens here is you take the iridium chloride dimer, which isn't water soluble, you put in the amine, which is, you can actually pull your product into solution, and this is what you get. So now we went back and looked at these rhodium things that were just kind of bothersome. And the report in the literature was from 1986, and the only way these compounds were identified, saying that they were ion pairs, was based on elemental analysis, which weren't very good, and molar conductivity data. But from our results, we're fairly certain now that if you use dimethylated and ethylene diamine derivative, you do produce the pentacoordinated atom and not the ion pair. This is contrary to previous reports in the literature, and we have proton and carbon NMR data and an elemental analysis that fits this structure. The next stage of this work was to decide if these things were going to be active for hydrogenation chemistry. And the first step in doing that was to see if they would just react with H2 itself. And what we found was when we started was with the simplest derivative, that's the ethylene diamine derivative, and in water, we bubbled H2 through it at 1 atmosphere and room temperature, and we found that the H2 oxidation we added going, taking the iridium-1 complex to iridium-3, and you get the dihydride. When you go to the monomethylethylene diamine case, you can see here that there's two isomers possible, one in which this methyl group is cis to 2 hydrides, and the other where it's cis to 1 hydride and trans to another. And at first, when I did this experiment, I found that I got a 2-to-1 product ratio and made one of the isomers in 2-to-1 preference over the other, but I had no idea which one was which. So that was, and we ended up making this conclusion, and I'll come back to how we did that in a minute. So I also looked at the hydrogenation of the dimethylated derivatives, and I think the NN prime dimethylethylene diamine case is quite interesting. And the others, remember that we got just a simple oxidative addition reaction. Well, here you liberate the cycloctadiene ring from the metal center. And what I propose is that the D2O, unless you do the experiment, and occupies the beta coordination sites to stabilize the complex. In the case of the NN dimethylethylene diamine, again, two isomers are possible, but only one was observed. And this is the one that's observed. And this was really, at first, again, I had no idea which one was observed and which one wasn't being, what wasn't being observed. And it looked like the same effect that was taking place in the monomethyl case was taking place here, but to a much larger extent. We couldn't figure out what it was. So I went back to the literature, and what I found was something that I think is really quite interesting, is hydrogen bonding. And what Bob Crabtree has shown, that you can actually have hydrogen bonding between an iridium hydride and a hydrogen attached to an electronegative element. This has been nitrogen as well. But if you look at that at first, you say, wait a minute, that's not what a hydrogen bond is. A hydrogen bond usually is between a hydrogen attached to an electronegative element and the electronegative element, not between two hydrogens. But you have to remember that a transition metal hydride is extremely anionic in character, very negative. So therefore, it can function as a very electronegative element and attract a hydrogen to it. One clarification on the slide. This isn't a formal bond. This is a hydrogen bond. It should be a dotted one. And what he was able to show in this complex was that the strength of this bond was about 4.3 kilocalories per mole. So now if we look at the dimethylated isomer again, you can see why the one isomer is preferred over the other. Here you can see that there's now an interaction where you have hydrogen bonding now between two cis dihydrides, where in this isomer, there's only one cis hydride to the NH2, and the hydrogen bonding interaction is increased. This isomer is actually sterically unfavorable because now you have the methyl group cis to the COD ring. The way we determined this was actually, I thought, quite interesting. Was through a nuclear Oberhauser effect NMR spectroscopy, doing the proton NMR, which actually measures the three-space interaction. If you pulse one of the hydrogens on one of these methyl groups, if it's in near proximity to another hydrogen, you can see enhancement of that signal. And what happens is when you pulse this hydrogen on this methyl group, you see enhancement of the COD olefin proton and not the aliphatic. In this isomer, you can see if this was the isomer formed, if you pulse these methyl groups, it's transitive COD ring, so the enhancement will be unlikely there. So now if we go back to the monomethyl ethylene diamine case, you can see why we have a 1-2 isomer preference. In the dominant isomer, you have the same situation as in the dimethylated case. We have two NH protons that can hydrogen bond to two iridium hydrides. Here in this isomer, it's not, you still have some hydrogen bonding between this hydrogen and these hydrides, but it's diminished. Similarly, we studied the hydrogenation of the rhodium amine complexes. And interestingly enough, we saw there was no reaction. So if you bubble H2 through these, if this is a room temperature and 1 atmosphere of HGs, you know no reaction. If you heat it up, you actually see decomposition of your complex. If you put some olefin in there, you actually can, I didn't study what was happening to the olefin, but I just realized that the complex wasn't decomposing. So based on these results, we realized we probably have potential for a nice aqueous homogeneous hydrogenation catalyst. So we figured we would study these in a simple system. That would be the hydrogenation of a simple water-soluble olefin, such as allyl alcohol. Not many reports have been presented on the hydrogenation of allyl systems. They're traditionally quite difficult to reduce. The reactions I studied were the reaction by proton NMR spectroscopy and carried them out in a high-pressure autoclave. The first catalyst I studied was the iridium NN prime dimethylethylene diamine chloride. And the reason why I picked this one first was, if you remember from the hydrogenation data, it hydrogenated the COD ring from the metal center. So I thought, well, that's a hydrogenation catalyst right there if it's liberating the olefin. So we'll look at this one first. And the first parameter I studied was the temperature dependent. And as you see, that as you increase the temperature, these rate constants, by the way, are measured as a disappearance of olefin. And you see an increase in the rate constant. So what I did was simply just construct an Arrhenius plot, and from the slope of that, you can determine the activation energy of the catalyst. And what I found was it was 29.3, basically 29 kilojoules per mole, significant figures. That's actually not correct there. In the literature, the only report of an allyl alcohol reduction was done by Wilkinson's catalyst, this triphenyl rhodium chloride. And the value for the activation energy there was 82 kilojoules per mole. And I think we have an extremely much lower value, and that's kind of bothersome in a sense. And I think that's due to an entropic entropic term in water, because this reaction was carried out in ethanol. Likewise, I studied the dependence of olefin concentration on the catalytic reaction. I found that the iridium NM prime dimethylethylene diamine complex were first order olefin concentration. A plot of the olefin versus time is linear, and that's how I determined that. Likewise, zero order plots and second order plots didn't fit nicely at all. And so likewise, the turnover frequency decreases throughout the course of the reaction. So when I'm talking about some of these things, when I talk about turnover frequency, I'll be referring to the same time interval. Likewise, look at the pressure dependence on the hydrogenation reaction. And I found that basically there is no effect of increased pressure. You see, I increased pressure threefold, and there's no effect on the turnover rate, really, with an experimental effect. Again, I'm doing this by product analyses by NMR, so the error is plus or minus 10% of the integration peak, so this is handled in that error treatment.
Is this a high Stirred reactor?
Yes, it's Stirred, yes.
Any effect of velocity of Stirred?
I've kept them constant, I didn't study that. If you remember from Crabtree's system, you saw that saw a marked enhancement from going from something like ethanol, which they were barely active, the iridium complexes, into something like methylene chloride. And he postulated that due to the coordinating power of the solvent, where acetone or an alcohol could coordinate to the metal and block the substrate from being reduced. So I figured, well, let's see how fast ours go. And I studied them in D2O acetone and methylene chloride. And what I found was that there was a nice increase in the turnover rate as you decrease the coordinating power of the solvent. One note here with methylene chloride is I believe that our complex being coordinatively unsaturated underwent an oxidative addition reaction with methylene chloride over time. In the first half hour, the reaction was going really quickly, comparatively. This is at room temperature, by the way, 174 cycles per hour, but I wasn't able to determine a rate constant because the catalyst dies extremely quickly. Another thing you have to keep into mind here, even though there wasn't a pressure dependence of H2, is a solubility factor in acetone and water. There could be something else going on in terms of not just base. I'm not just going to base my conclusion on coordinating power of the solvent. Well, I want to see if any of the other iridium complexes that I had synthesized were active for olefin reduction. And I picked the simplest one, that was iridium C of the ethylene diamine chloride. And this was had similar activity to the NN prime complex turnover rates at a half hour around 115 and 140. This is a 40 degrees C and 200 psi of H2. And the rate constants are fairly similar. So what this showed is that it gave us some really nice mechanistic information, which I'll show you. Even though the rhodium complexes didn't oxidatively add H2, I figured they could possibly act as hydrogenation catalysts. And I studied them in a similar manner as the iridium complexes. And the first thing that I found, they were zero order in olefin, which was exactly not in agreement with the iridium complexes, which were first order. These were dependent on the pressure of H2, which makes sense if you think about it now, that these didn't add H2 under room temperature conditions like the iridium complexes do. Presumably because rhodium hydride bonds aren't as thermodynamically stable as iridium hydride bonds. There are several reports of that in the literature. So adding H2 to the rhodium complex is quite difficult. So that actually would be the slow step of the reaction, and you see a dependence in the rate law. This half order, I'm a little skeptical of that right now. I'm not real sure about the solubility of H2 in water is about 10% of what it is in an organic solvent. But I don't know how I don't think that's linear with pressure. So the amount of H2 I have in solution with increasing pressure might vary, so you can't get a nice relationship. But I think the important thing to note here is there is a dependence on H2 pressure. Similarly, I did an activation energy study and found that the activation energy is 39.7 kilojoules per mole. And with these complexes, since they did go, these were a little bit more active than the iridium complexes, so I decided to study some acetylene reductions as well. And with the rhodium complexes, I was getting around 200 turnovers per hour at 40 degrees C. And when I put the acetylene in there, I would get about 20. So you can say, well, great, there's selective olefin reducing catalysts, but that's not really what you want. I really would like to like form to reduce the acetylene to the olefin and just stop there and have a nice selective catalyst, but like Schrock and Osborne did, but that's just not the case. I think what's happening is you form some kind of stable pi complex with the acetylene. If you look at a terminal acetylene, that's traditionally been a problem in the literature because the terminal acetylene, the pKa of that hydrogen is 25 or so. So you can actually have an oxidative addition to the acetylene and the hydrogen. And I also looked at, briefly with these, is some internal olefins, and they were active. The rhodium complexes were, did reduce them at a reasonable rate, faster than the acetylenes, but not quite as fast as the terminal olefin. Well, from these data, we're able to propose a catalytic cycle. And this is where I basically put all the kinetic work together and came up with the cycle. And the entry into the cycle is up here at the top, where the ethylene diamine and the NN prime results help this out. The rate for the NN prime is similar to the ethylene diamine in the iridium case. And basically, that shows you that the COD ring probably isn't involved in the catalytic, isn't on any of your transition metals when it's in the catalytic cycle. So the ethylene diamine might have an induction period where you have to hydrogenate off the COD ring, which takes longer than the NN prime case. So after you form this complex, it's stabilized probably by a solvent molecule such as D2O or acetone. And again, here, this is where you can see the methylene chloride work would come into play, where if this can't coordinate, it would just oxidate as the end. Here you have coordination of your olefin. Migratory insertions give you the alkyl complex, and then inductive elimination give you the alkane. Regenerating the square planar complex, which then can add H2 and start the cycle all over again. Here's the conclusions for the catalytic work. The rhodium complex was slightly more active than iridium, but not tremendously. I think the most important thing from this work is that the kinetics of each system was unique. Oftentimes, you read in the literature, people doing iridium chemistry, they often say, well, we're studying iridium because rhodium is too active or whatever. But once you make the iridium stuff, well, we can just draw conclusions to the rhodium. And as I've shown here, that you just can't do that. Both here are operating by completely under different kinetics due to H2 addition, things like that. And both the rhodiumamine and the iridiumamine complex provide lower energy pathways than the Mokas's catalyst for the reduction of alkyl alcohol. In summary, we're able to show that we can make several coordinately unsaturated, water soluble iridiumamine and rhodiumamine complexes. That the reactivity wasn't as much determined by the degree of substitution on the amine, but by which solvent you use in the synthesis. Iridium-amine complexes undergo a facile reaction with dihydrogen, which you'll see in the next talk given by Dr. Morolla, that in order to generate the iridium P3H2 catalyst, that requires pretty, not forcing conditions, but 80 degrees C in acetylene, where these undergo facile reactions at room temperature, one atmosphere of H2O. And both iridium and rhodium And then from Diamond Left Lane Diamond Complex is our active hydrogenation catalyst in aqueous solution. I think this work is really just the tip of the iceberg for this type of chemistry. This is the first generation of catalysts that have been developed for this type. So I have a lot of ideas for future work. First of all the other catalytic activity, the other complexes, needs to be determined. And I think probably one of the most interesting ones there would be the tetramethylethylene diamine, because we're seeing some hydrogen bonding effects that could actually slow your hydrogenation, could slow your migratory insertion if there's an interaction between the hydride and the NH of your amine. Further investigation of the hydrogen bonding interaction between a transition metal hydride and the amine ligand. Actually, right now, I'm doing some work where we're trying to add steric bulk to one side of the amine and see how far we can actually push the unfavorable steric interaction versus hydrogen bonding. I've actually made the NN diethyl case and did the hydrogenation. I've only seen one isomer form there as well. So that gives you an idea of how strong the hydrogen bonding interaction. And possibly determine the potential of these compounds as aqueous catalysts for olefin hydroformylations. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge some of the people who have helped me along the way in performing this research. First off is my advisor, Dr. Marola. Second of all, some people in the Marola group. Rob Pafford is a graduate student in the group who's helped me prepare some of the slides and things like that. Marion Franks has done some C13 NMR spectroscopy, and Shannon has helped me out with some literature work. Finally, Analytical Services, I have to tell my joke, they were instrumental. They were instrumental in helping me with the NOE experiment. And finally, the National Science Foundation for financial support. And you for your attention.
Paper is open for discussion. Any questions? Paul? Yes.
Have you ever considered these being ferrocationic, putting them on azelaic or clay and seeing how they perform?
No, I haven't considered it. I would imagine you could use them as
hydrogenation for ease of separation.
Right. Yeah, like I said, I think the main reason that I haven't thought of that is just I'm just trying to figure out which ones are catalytically active and why they are and how they are first, and this being the first generation.
Some work was done back in the 70s, putting rhodium in the iridium complex in place, but not even water-soluble ones, so that's
right.
Interesting.
Do you have an occasion with your other solvent, your methylene chloride, your acetone, to look at the hydrogen kinetics or your activation energy?
That's the next step. I meant to put that in my future work, that with that entropic interaction that we're proposing is happening with H2O, that would be nicely borne out if we did the an acetone, especially, because there's no reaction with methylene. There's no reaction between the complex and the acetone. So that would be nice to do the activation energy in acetone and determine if that's what the case, if it's a solubility problem or entropic. Yes? No, and the reason why these were done in D2O was just because I was monitoring by NMR and pulling, just sampling right from the reactor, putting it in an NMR tube. But you notice I didn't say I used D6 acetone or D2 methylene chloride. One was kind of expensive, and second, that I was going to go back and do some of them in H2O because my peaks don't, which that's what's nice about allyl alcohol, is another thing I didn't mention. Was that the starting material and the product don't overlap in resonance between, in the NMR spectrum. So I think you could probably use H2O and see if there is an isotope effect in your solvent. Another possibility is just to analyze the reaction by a gas chromatography thing that we don't have to worry about. So that's definitely future work.
Can I ask another quick kinetic question? Did you look at the kinetic order of the catalyst? Especially in water.
Yes, and at first, actually the reason why I didn't do it, because I never went back and looked at it, is I doubled the concentration of it and I saw no effect. And I was like, my ass screwed up. And I showed it to Dr. Marola and he says, that's no way that's going on. And so I actually went back in the literature, and the people who did the allyl alcohol study using Wilkinson's catalyst, is what they found is that the curve isn't linear for catalyst concentration. It actually goes up and then drops off. And if you're a too concentrated of a solution, then all you are is up on the top part of that curve where it's flat. And that's where I was. So I haven't gone back and gone to a really, really dilute solution yet. And that's what I need to do to determine that. I'm sure, I think that's exactly, I was like, I think 10 orders of magnitude more concentrated than they were. So I was definitely up on that region.
And no further questions. Let's thank Paul again. Resume here, 1 o'clock after lunch.
Why don't you look at the story?